Hello, my name is Nicole Wunderling, and I manage the X-ray scattering facilities for Penn State's Materials Characterization Laboratory. The purpose of this video is to give you an introduction to the technique known as X-ray diffraction. At the end of this presentation, you should have a general idea of what the technique is primarily used for. The basic theory of the technique was developed by the father and son team of Sir William Henry and Sir William Lawrence Bragg in 1913. The duo would go on to win a Nobel Prize for their work. It's worth noting that the younger part of the team, the son, Sir William Lawrence, was only 25 years old when he received this prize. He is still the youngest person in science ever to receive a Nobel. The theory that they developed we know today as Bragg's Law. It's a simple equation that says n lambda equals 2d sine theta, where n will be assumed to be 1, and lambda is what we call the wavelength. And in this example, we'll be making the assumption that we're using a copper X-ray tube, so we know that our wavelength is approximately 1.5 angstroms. Theta is what we call the incidence angle, shown here in green, and it represents the angle that the incident X-ray beam makes with the surface of the sample. D is what we call the lattice interplanar spacing, shown here. We commonly just call this the D value, and it represents the distance between planes of atoms in a crystal structure that are situated parallel to the surface of the sample. Constructive interference occurs when Bragg's law is satisfied at some particular angle and some particular distance, or D value. That constructive interference is reported or detected in two different ways. If you're using a system that uses a 2D image detector, you'll get an image that looks something like this for a randomly oriented powder material. Or if you're using a system which uses directly plots the data, you'll get a 1D plot of degrees to theta on the x-axis and intensity in counts or counts per second on the y-axis. This particular example is for cubic body-centered iron, and it represents what we call the fingerprint for this particular material. By comparing this pattern to known patterns in a database, an analyst can determine the structure and composition of the materials in their sample. This is perhaps the number one reason that people employ the technique of X-ray diffraction. In addition to a single compound sample, like the one we showed previously, the technique has the advantage of being able to detect multiple compounds in a specimen. In this example, we have a material which contains two different forms of calcium carbonate. The first is what is known as calcite, and calcite has a hexagonal structure. The second is the form we call vaterite, and it has an orthorhombic structure. Notice that the reference lines for calcite have been superimposed on our pattern using this teal color, and the reference pattern for vaterite is in pink. So each individual fingerprint is different because the structures have different distances between those planes of atoms within their respective structures. You can take this analysis to the next level if you perform something called a Rietveld refinement or hole pattern fitting analysis, which can be used to get quantitative information, how much of each particular phase is present, in addition to things like highly accurate lattice parameters. The major advantages of the technique, we've already mentioned that it is a good way to get structure and lattice parameters. It's fair to say that it's probably the fastest and most economical way to do so. It is a non-destructive technique. The sample preparation is relatively simple in most cases. It is a bulk technique, which means that you're getting data that represents a rather large number of crystallites in the material. So it gives you an average of the material. Your samples can be in a variety of forms. They can be powders, bulk samples, or thin films. And there is a large volume of reference data available for comparison. You get both qualitative and quantitative information in most cases. And the experiments can be done in air, no need for any type of special evacuated chamber. I also list the fact that this is a bulk technique under a disadvantage, because if you really need to look at a small area of your sample, this can be challenging with this technique, particularly on a conventional powder diffractometer. It is not a surface sensitive technique. We are typically penetrating up to about 100 microns, and your detection limits will be relatively high. We generally need low weight percents of a particular material to be present before we can detect it. It is highly sensitive to sample preparation techniques, and if sample preparation is not done correctly, the analysis can be difficult, if not impossible, to analyze. There is the fact that you're working with X-rays, so there's a hazard involved there. And we get the most information when working with crystalline materials, and solid materials, I should say. Liquids, gases generally don't work very well, and we can identify amorphous materials, but classic X-ray diffraction gives the most information from solid crystalline materials. Typical applications, we've already mentioned structure and composition and identification of crystalline and amorphous phases, but we can also determine orientation and texture. We can evaluate strain and crystallite size, and overall, the tool is simply an excellent quality control or process monitoring technique. Some technical details, you can measure a vast array of materials, including things like metals, ceramics, polymers, pharmaceuticals, and geological specimens. Our irradiated spatial areas vary from a low of perhaps 50 micron on a micro diffraction instrument up to tens of millimeters on a conventional powder diffractometer. There are a variety of in situ stages available, including heating, cooling, gas, vacuum, and pressure. I hope that this short introduction to the technique of X-ray diffraction has been useful for you. If you have additional questions or comments, please feel free to contact me